Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And it gives me great pleasure to see such a healthy attendance for our session. I bring you somebody spectacular. I bring you a Titanic who met an iceberg, and the iceberg broke to pieces, and this Titanic emerged the winner. I talk about the JCB Literary Prize, the inaugural one, and Benyamin is a winner, and his book was a translation, and it's completely a no-no among literary prizes. Nobody gives a major prize to a translation. So I want a huge round of applause for Benyamin and his achievement. Now, I must tell you that yesterday when I was walking out of the hotel, I saw him go past and I said, oh, that's Benyamin. And you know, there is a kind of a caste system among writers, and the lowest caste, which is the untouchables, are the people like me who write romance. And you know, any writer worth his salt would not, it's not only that he would not touch me, he would not see me. We are invisible as well. And this gentleman turned. We said, we have a picture with you, and he spent some time with us. And then me being me, asked that question. I asked him, what are you going to do with that 25 lakhs? And he was a little shocked. But don't worry, by the end of this session, I am going to find out what he's going to do with that 25 lakhs. So I would, you know, he has had a really interesting life, and I would like to ask him to give us a little introduction about himself.
Myself, Benyamin, actually my original name is Benny Daniel. I am from Kerala. I wrote almost 25 books in Malayalam, but only 3 is translated into English. 2 of them are published by Penguin Books. One is God Days, another one is Yellow Lights of Death. The third one is Jasmine Days, recently published by Juggernaut. And actually, I was an engineer in Gulf for last 21 years. I never thought myself I will be a writer in later period. But when I reach Gulf in the age of 21, I do have a lot of time to spend after my work, 8 hours work, what I have to do. I tried to see some films in Malayalam, but it was not at all impressed me. And then I turned to reading. In the earlier stage, even in the school or college days, I never read a book. Maybe a children's book or a time pass. But then after almost 8 years, I was in a reading only. My first short story published in age of 28 or 29, like that. Then from last 20 years, I wrote 25 books, included 7 novels, 4 short story collection, 3-4 travelogue, and thank you for readers, because only because of the reader is I continue my writing. Each book got some award from somewhere, some appreciation from the readers. From last 5 years, I am living as a writer only. I left my job in the Gulf, and I'm stay back in Kerala. And thank you, readers, because of the royalty only. From the royalty only, I am leaving. That is, I think it is a very rare case a reader can live with the royalty. But as a regional writer, I am so happy. Malayalam is a vibrant language, and lot of readers. And so I don't know what else I have to tell.
It makes me so happy, the role I have now, because I love to get these quiet, tall, dark, handsome South Indian men speak, you know, particularly those quiet ones who don't want to talk. I love to needle them and get them to talk. So it's, you know, I'm going to have a great time for the next 20 minutes. Could you let me know if you have any particular memories of an inspiration that pushed you towards writing?
Not a particular memory. As I told you earlier, I was a reader in that period. And that period, I had a chance that I write lot of letters to my friends. This is my writing experience started. Before that, I don't had any experience with writing and all, but I wrote lot of letters to my friends. And in that letter, I tried to show my vision, my ambitions or my dreams and all. Then my friends were telling that, oh, those letters were so beautiful, like that. Then I tend to write some articles on books and like that. Later stage, I thought that I do have some stories with me, because so many people living in abroad, especially in the Gulf countries, from past 50 years, but nobody write well about the Gulf life. Always some writers are there, but they are always writing about India or writing about Kerala and their memories, their nostalgia and all. But nobody is writing about the Gulf, what is going on there, how the people are surviving there. So this is, as a person who knows little bit about writing or language, I thought this is my duty to tell the world some rare stories with me. I think the Gulf life is the inspiration of my writing career.
So this we all know that every village in Kerala has these huge houses that have come up with Gulf money. So the sons go, sons and the grandsons go abroad, and then they send money back, and then you have these huge mansions. And that's that story of prosperity, And do you feel that there is a need for the people back home to know what is behind that prosperity, behind the money that they are sending back?
This is the actual thing. Nobody knows what is happening in the Gulf countries. Everybody is seeing the prosperity, the lighting part of the Gulf only. Very few person only getting that much of money and making money, but many of them are struggling well in those countries. But nobody is trying to tell. They are coming with a well dress and a good shoes and showing some color in our land. Actually, one of my writer was saying that all those dresses and shoes was brought just day before he is leaving from the country and spending all the money in Kerala or for the house or all other things. But as a writer, I am living there. This is, as I told you earlier, this is my duty to tell what type of struggle is going on there and what type of life is going on there. Many of them are not trying to tell even to the family. When you are asking to a person in Kerala, where is your son, what are he doing, he is in Dubai, he is in Abu Dhabi, he is in Saudi, there is no job. The job is the country's name is the job. This is what in actually nobody knows what the son or brother or father what type of job he is doing there. He is not willing to reveal to the family also, this is what I am doing, this is my stage. So I think we must say or we must reveal to the family, this is what I am doing, such type of struggle is going on me. Like that, we have to tell that.
This particular book, which is spectacularly written and has such lovely, lovely insights to this particular experience that he's talking about. It is seen through the eyes of this really naive young girl whose name is Samira, and she's of Pakistani nationality. Why did you choose a Pakistani heroine?
When I am writing a novel, I always think about how it will reach to the reader. In what perspective I have to tell. Maybe there are so many characters in this novel. The Samira is there, her father is there, other boyfriend, Ali is from the other part of the country is there. Which perspective is better? I thought the Samira's version is the best way to tell the story. The story is about the Jasmine Revolution, that is the Arab Revolution, and the period, how the people will survive those area, those time, and what are the problems they faced by the nationals and the expatriates. I thought this is the best way. The Samira is the best person to tell the story from this side. Actually, in original in Malayalam, it is a teen novel. Along with this novel, there is another book also. It is named in Malayalam Al Arabian Novel Factory. That novel is telling the same story or same period. It is telling by another character, a journalist Pradab from Canada. He is trying to tell the same story from the other end, and the Samira is telling from the other side. So this is a twin novel. Actually, in English it is published this portion only. The other version is publishing by next year. So,
oh, lovely. So we have something to look forward to. Beautiful.
Both are interconnected. You can read any book at the beginning and you can go to the next book from this connection. Both are linked together. That's why the book is written. I do have so many friends in Gulf with a Pakistani connection. I lived with them. I played cricket with them. We ate together. We shared accommodation together. So I know what is the Pakistani life, and it is so related to our life also. While we are seeing from here, Pakistan is a maybe an enemy country, or we are seeing them as something different. But when we are mingling together, I am seeing that we are all are same, and the story is same. That's why I choose Samira as the protagonist.
Very, very nice answer. Also, the growth that you have shown in Samira. Like, she starts off as a really naive young girl who is exploring the world and actually has stars in her eyes. And as she grows, she sees, you know, various things that make her more politically aware. Was this planned? And, you know, how strongly did you want to have her develop into a powerful woman character?
The question is, for what you are writing a novel? To tell the story or something else? In my case, I am trying to tell a story, tell something else through this story. I want to tell what had happened in those days in Middle East, and what type of struggle we faced and all. So from the beginning, maybe the Samira was so naive. She's an RJ in the radio, and later she knows
exposed.
That yeah, she exposed into the society, and related to so many people in the community, and she understand what is the fighting between Sunnis and Shias, what type of marginalization is going on in some area. Such things are happening. So I want to tell what is the real political situation in those areas. So I choose some character and I place them in between, and I'm trying to tell from different angle.
Thank you so much. One of the things that, you know, that I observed in this book, and you know, it is quite a powerful thing to find in a writer, is that this book is actually, it is politics. It talks about, you know, a very, very powerful politically, the Arab Spring that we know it as. It's a very powerful, politically charged period that we are talking about. But actually, it is history as it is happening. And all of us have been alive for a lot. Like, you know, I realize that I have lived through the emergency, but I can't write about it. So what equipped you to be able to write for this? Did you take notes or did you do research later? How did this work out?
No, I do have so many first-hand information about this experience. When those incidents were happening, I was there. I was there in that city. So and also I have so many Arab friends and they informed me what is happening, what is their political ambition, what type of suppression they are facing, what type of marginalization they are facing. It is a Shia majority country and ruled by a Sunni, and what is the conflict between those Shias and Sunnis. So I do have so many experience, and I got so many experience from the friends also. This is what the basic of the novel.
Right. So basically, you're a very good researcher. You have all your material and then you weave it into a story that actually unfolds history for the reader. Is that what you're trying to do?
Normally, I am collecting so many materials for the story. Then later period, I tried to join all together. Normally, maybe some writers maybe start from the chapter one and then slowly developing the plot, and then it is going through that. But in my case, I do have the story in my mind, and I write maybe a chapter 22 at the first, and then 15, then 72, or like that. In the later period, I will connect these stories, those incidents, and those memories, or something which I want to say in a chain like that. This is the way I am writing. Maybe each writer have their own style, but in my case, this is what I am doing.
I think I'm going to take that as a writer tip, and I'm going to, so the next award might come to me because I know the secret. I also was a little intrigued about, of course, Samira's boyfriend, but more that, there is this kind of a brutality of the establishment within, the Gulf. But at the same time, Samira realizes that her family back in Pakistan, which belongs to a police, I think, background, is also a kind of an establishment, and it has its own flaws as well. Would you like to talk a little more about it?
So difficult, because we are all related to some
police family
or some systems. We are related to some system. We are belongs to that. So whenever we are saying that we are free person, or we are not belongs to someone, but we are hooked up or locked with something else. So as an expatriate, the Samira's family has nothing to do with those country, but still they are the part of the ruling family. They are the part of the torturing team. At the same time, they are also the sufferers. All the at a time they are suffering, and they are the team of the torturing also. So that is very, very paradoxical situation, I think. So the family itself suffering, because Samira's father is a policeman, her other relatives also working with the police department, and at the same time his lover is in the other part. He is willing to kill this policeman. So many complicated things are happening in our life. This is what I try to write in novel. That's all.
Yeah, so this story, while it does have a central character and it has a powerful central message, a powerful picture of a central history, it's also in terms of, it's very richly woven, almost like a Kanjivaram sari, with lots of strands of threads and beautiful little side stories that come together in this book. So what is your next novel going to be about?
Next book, it is in my mind. I don't know it's about what, but I wish to write about Kerala history from 18th century. But the latest book I published is it's also about the Kerala from the period of 1975 to 1995. In a village, what has happened in those period? We know that that period is very, very interesting in Indian politics. The emergency, death of Indira Gandhi, the the Golden Temple issue and so many assassination of Rajiv Gandhi.
Khalistan movement, insurgency.
And so many things have happened in our country, the declination of communism. So many things have happened. All this history, how it is affected in a village, small village, and this is what I am trying to tell in my latest book.
Okay. So, is it already published?
Yeah, it is already published in Malayalam.
Okay. I hope we can get to read a translation soon.
Hope so. I think this JCB award will encourage more translation from so many regional languages. This is what my happiness, not about the money and all. Money, I am going to put it in the bank. Nothing else I can do with I don't
See,
know.
See, I got the answer. I said I would get the answer by the end of...
Because, as you said earlier, we consider the Indian English writers were the most brilliant writers. They are brilliant and good, but there are so many other brilliant writing is happening in the regional writing also. We may get more translation from the other languages. The JCB Award will help help it.
I truly believe that, you know, the best cinema is regional cinema and the best literature is regional literature. I don't think we have come of age to that level. You know, we do not have that maturity in mainstream writing in English, you know, Indian writing in English as we have in our regional languages.
The main problem we are facing is the translation. We don't have much good translators to communicate with to the other world.
Right.
Fortunately, I got a good translation for this book, Shahnaz Habib. She is from USA and she knows how to communicate with the international reader. This is very important.
Right.
As a writer, every writer is addressing someone. Most of the regional writers have a problem that they are addressing the regional readers only. So whenever it is translating, we have to develop something, we have to say something more on the book. Maybe for example, in Malayalam I am saying that a character's name is some Nair or something. It is all included, his caste is included, his belief is included, so many things are included. When it is going to the international leader, we have to develop that and we have to say something more about the character. Such translation is needed in future. Then only we can get a more international readership. This is what, fortunately, I got such a good translator.
So this will be my last very brief question. Has the award changed your life?
I don't think so, because if it is an award or it may be a criticism, I don't mind that much, because my duty is to write something. I am always in a dream for a new book, not about award or anything else.
Wonderful. So I'm now going to throw the session open for questions. We have very little time, so please keep your question brief. Make sure it's a question. Please don't give us a comment. Yes. Do we have any questions? Come on, award-winning man.
Hi, my name is Nishara. I wanted to ask you said that you wrote the book as a two-part novel, one from Samira's perspective and one from the journalist's perspective. So I wanted to ask, so when you were writing the story, were you writing it simultaneously as well? Or did you finish one piece and then go to another, or one chapter here, one chapter there?
No, actually, in the beginning, I thought it is a single book. When I collect the material from different areas, I realized that the book will not be complete in one book or one perspective. If I am saying in one perspective, other will be remain blank. So in the later period, I divided into two, and the incidents divided, and so it was writing in simultaneously in the initial part. Then this is what happened in this case here.
Yes, please. Can somebody give that lady a mic?
Thank you. My question is actually about the translation process. How involved were you in the translation process? What is the working relationship between the writer and the translator? You know, is it, you don't just give your book and let someone else write it. How does that work?
Most interesting part is we never met each other. Even today, because she is in New York, I am in Kerala, and we communicated each other through emails and phone calls. I give her so many freedom on translation, because if I insist that it should be like that, what I wrote, the translation will not be possible. We should give some freedom to the translator. What I am thinking that the translation must have a connection like that with the water and steam. The original work is water, and the translation is the steam. So in the steam there is a water, but I don't want to become me is the right. She have some freedom, but she communicated with me in so many cases what to do with this paragraph and how it is, what can I do with this. Such a good relation we had. That's why this happened. This is what I am saying.
I'll take one last question because we are running out of time. One question.
Sir, do you plan to translate your books to other Indian languages?
I wish, but the God days, that is translated into many other languages, that is translated into Tamil, Kannada, Odia, then other language, Nepali, Thai, then Urdu, Arabic and all. If someone is interested in this book or anything, I am so happy. But the inter-language translation in India is not that much possible, because we need an English translation for other translation. This is what we are facing on the translation issue. We cannot translate a Malayalam book directly into the Marathi or Gujarati. This is what we are facing. But if someone is interested, I am so happy.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's all that we have in this session. Please give the warmest applause to our newest prize winner of the JCV Literary Award. And thank you for being such a pleasant and wonderful audience. Good evening and bye.